Virginia Heffernan is a journalist, critic, and author, most recently of Magic and Loss, the Internet as Art. She has been called, and she can blush all she wants, it's blushable, America's preeminent cultural critic, a public intellectual for the 21st century, among the finest living writers of English prose. Kevin Kelly, the co-founder of Wired, writes, Heffernan is a new species of wizard. It's a joy and revelation to be under her spell. My colleague Edward Mendelsohn, writing the New York Review of Books, called Magic and Loss a surprisingly moving and ecstatic narrative of submission. Knowing Edward Mendelsohn as well as I do, I suspect he would have liked to engage further with Virginia about the submission and about the ecstasy, but he's unfortunately not able to be with us. Virginia has served as articles editor at Talk Magazine, senior editor at Harper's Magazine, elders and critics at Slate. In 2002, and I think I'm getting these things in the right order, she received a PhD in English and American Literature from Harvard. She spent 4 years as a television critic at the New York Times, the Daily Times, where in addition to writing reviews and features, she chronicled the convergence of TV and the internet. From 2008 to 2012, she wrote a weekly column for the New York Times Magazine called The Medium, dealing with internet culture. This is quite a CV. From 2012 to 2014, she was national correspondent at Yahoo News. From 2015 to 2016, she was a visiting scholar of the Department of Media, Culture, and Communications at NYU, and editorial director of West, a venture capital firm in San Francisco. Anyone contemplating a startup, she's available for consultation. She's written for The New Yorker, Mother Jones, New York Magazine, Salon, MTV, Political Vice, quite a number of other publications. She's appeared a lot on TV, on the radio. She is, among other things, a really interesting example of what you can do with a PhD if you're not going to have an academic career. I mean, not that anyone can expect this kind of, but still. The invitation for her to speak here comes really out of my experience of hearing her speak about Magic and Loss at the New School in spring, which made me want to read Magic and Loss. And reading Magic and Loss made me aware of a quality of aesthetic excitement, both the book's subject and also its mode, that I really haven't found in many places. It's not techno-utopian, it's very hard-headed, it's philosophically very sophisticated, but it's a lot less gloom-inducing than a great deal of what is written about the internet, or for that matter, walking up and down the steps of Hamilton Hall while your students are texting. So it's really wonderful having her here. She is somebody who is incapable of writing adult sentence, and there are very few people about whom this can be said. So please join me in welcoming Virginia.
Very much. Bruce and I had a, after the New School, we had a wonderful dinner together, I put some notes down, but I thought I'd tell you how I came to the internet. Maybe like some of you, I started when I was nine. The only difference is that, from you, is that I was nine in 1979. It was the ARPANET era, and the EVE networks had sort of appeared on the West Coast. By chance, on the East Coast, Dartmouth College had managed to, the local college my father taught, had managed to attract John Kemeny, one of the co-authors of the computer language BASIC, to be the president of the school, first teach in the math department, be the president. The 60s and 70s, you think of computing as an engineering project, a military project, possibly with some commercial applications. You don't think of it as a tool for the humanities, but Kemeny did. And it may be partly because he wrote a natural language form of computer code, programming code, but one of the first things he wanted to do was get Robert Frost, who's the Hungarian computer programmer, get Robert Frost in some kind of computer archive. So that was happening at a level I didn't know. Now, Hanover is a colonial town and has certain just hundreds of years old obligations to the town folk. We have town meetings and so forth. And this is important because Kennedy wanted to build a computer center on campus, and in exchange for the real estate, the colonial real estate, he was obliged to do something for the school children. And he fulfilled his obligation by giving us a lecture on BASIC. And the parents were encouraged to think this was a good idea because the highest aspiration of man was, of course, that your children would work for NASA, one day work for NASA 10 years after the moon landing. So we were told that if we were ever going to make anything of ourselves and work for NASA, we needed to go to this discussion of how to program in BASIC. So after the lecture, where we learned to say, like, you know, happy birthday, Virginia, and my brother's an idiot in the program, almost everybody filed out except for five of us, and it was four boys and me. And we came to the front of the room, and we just had to see more. We wanted to see more. So if we wanted to see more, we needed to go over to that computer center. And so I walked over across the campus to Kiewit and met my first SysProg, system programmers. They were college men, boys, 19, 20, and they the word SysProg started to seem to me like the word lead singer seems to other girls. Like, I just couldn't get enough of the SysProgs. And they, at first I pretended to be interested in really learning BASIC, but what I wanted was to do the things that they did, which were like versions of fantasy games like Dungeons and Dragons. And so they hacked me in, or they got me into a game called Excalibur. And it had all kinds of, it had this ambiance of like Arthurian Knights of the Round Table mixed with Led Zeppelin. There were references to like damsels and steeds and this like 70s bombast that was like very interesting to me. And I got my first avatar, and I got my first computer name. So I was 9, turning 10, and naturally I settled on Athena. So so I was suddenly Athena Online, and on Conference XYZ, which I didn't call online, we didn't call it the internet, obviously we didn't call it a social network, we called it playing the computer. And when we played the computer, we dialed in, I convinced my parents to buy me a terminal, a dumb terminal, which is something like a Chromebook now. It's like just an empty-headed endpoint for cloud information. But in those days, you dialed in using a coupler and a modem. And it was the first time I heard, there were two sensory experiences that I can't forget that are still in my mind. The first was the sound, the squeal and crash of information coming through my phone. The like, eesh.
What year?
Sorry?
What year?
Oh, what year? 79. Yes. Are you going to tell me 49 you heard it?
No, the bulletin board community.
Yeah, I missed the bulletin boards, exactly. So this was slightly different. It was a time-sharing system at Dartmouth College. So part of the reason that Kevin wanted to open up, and I should say Thomas Kuntz, his co-author of BASIC, wanted to open this system up is that they wanted people in the humanities to be able to use computers. I'm not sure if this was pressure at Dartmouth. You know, Dartmouth is a college only. It doesn't have graduate programs and is maybe more concentrates on liberal arts, or if it was a better way to get invited to the cocktail parties or to, you know, associate with poets, or maybe they just had a poetic streak like a lot of technologists. But there's a real emphasis on getting people in the humanities to use computers. And so the idea that this was, I signed on as Athena, I heard that squeal and crash of information, and I then proceeded to tie up our one family phone line hours and hours and hours on end. I mean, I definitely did this more than kids watch television, more than people are on their phones. If one of my parents dared to pick up the phone line downstairs and wreck my connection, suddenly you've been terminated. I was furious. And my mother like would yell up to me, and this is significant, stop playing the computer. That was the only, like, not get off the internet, not whatever, but playing the computer. And partly my sort of being mesmerized by that sound that I just described, that squeal crash sound, then hearing that play in the computer, and then this third thing that's most important, which is the look of the phosphor letters on the screen, green phosphor letters, like the color of peridots, against a black infinite background, you know, like the opening of Star Wars. And it was just this black hole. And those three things, the idea that what I was doing was playing with a machine, playing the computer, maybe playing against the computer, but somehow playing the computer. And whatever that, all the information in the world that had somehow come through the phone that I, you know, usually talked to like a childhood friend or my grandmother on, and then that dark background, those three things made it impossible for me not to get theological about this experience. You know, I started to try to wonder what was back there. And since the words coming in the front were so evocative, they were the language I just described about you know, Apollo and Athena and runes and things in Led Zeppelin songs, and ultimately, you know, as I got a little more proficient, Reaganomics, the, you know, Farrah Fawcett, you know, things in the news and on television. Where were all those things coming from? And what possibly could be generating such an exciting experience in the foreground? You know, all these college kids and merchant marines and people at Bates and mysterious people who didn't tell you where they were dialing in from, where was all this coming from? And then this just obsessive invention of this character of Athena, that, you know, I didn't know if I was going to write an all lowercase or be a mixed case person like the cisprogs, or skip spaces, two spaces between sentences like people who've, you know, been taught to type properly, or write in all caps like the Marines did, and use that reply all space, the like public space, to yell. And you could get killed on this system. You could get kicked off and be suddenly terminated by the master, but that was usually the first person who'd signed on that day. And sometimes that guy would be really prudish. So if you type something in public space in all caps using swear words, he'd say, "Keep it clean, folks," and shoo, that person would be snuffed out. So I knew there were consequences to character creation in this space. I definitely didn't want to be like too flirty. I was too young to really know what I was getting into. Fortunately, maybe for me, because I probably would have been open to a predator or two, it turned out, I later found out when I wrote about this in the Times, that it was a gay cruising site. And the guys were like, they totally were onto me as a child, you know? I would be like, "I'm 18, I look like Raquel Welch." And they were just like, "What were you saying again about Reaganomics?" You know, they like worked around that. So, you know, basically what I learned was, under cover of this, in this masquerade, which, you know, where my imagination went wild, was room for this just extraordinary fictional enterprise. Obviously, it became very emotional to me when I would like make a friend or get close to someone or flirt with someone, and I'd wonder about the person and all that, but I didn't mistake it for reality, you know? I knew that I wasn't Athena, and I knew that, you know, when my mother broke the phone line and I had to get off, that I went back to my other life. What I liked online was my authorship, was my, you know, ability to make this character, write dialogue for her, and get into this massively multiplayer online role-playing game that is the internet. So that dark space, much later, maybe like some of you, I grew very enchanted, and this is why I say I didn't mistake it for reality, with Eric Auerbach's book, My Mimesis. And the thing that stood out to me in it was his account of the so-called Eloist, the author of the Torah and the Old Testament, as being very gifted with parataxes, with so-called weak connectives. So the example of paratactic speech not from the Bible is Veni, Vidi, Vici. So I came, I saw, I conquered. If you were going to write that with stronger connectives, you might say, Caesar might have said something like, having determined that the ends of the Roman Empire were expansion, and having come on this, you know, and mindful of my own bloodlust, I observed this, you know, and so on, and sacked it. But instead, you're left to wonder about what are the motivations, what are the what happened in those blank spaces between those three assertions. And the same is true, you know, with God said, "Let there be light," and there was light. A more paratactic writer, like I actually was looking at the Times today. A more hypotactic writer. That's the tight connectives with lots of subordinate clauses. As a journalist for a long time, I've really learned that style. I was looking at the Times today, and there was, you know, a nice example of this very tight style. I promise that this is leading somewhere. Today's Times. On Tuesday, Pentagon officials refused to say whether they would comply with their part of the deal, which calls on the United States to share information with the Russians on Islamic State targets in Syria if the ceasefire holds for 7 days. It's very, very hard to have a sentence like that lead you to speculate about what's behind it. You know, you take them at their word because it has numbers in it, because it has these subordinate clauses in it. And God said, "Let there be light," and there was light, you begin to speculate, and as Auerbach says, see the face of God in language like that. And this sort of weak connectives into which you interpolate or hypostatize some prime mover was visible to me on that first screen. So, you can imagine a time before bitmaps, a time before pixmaps, a time before your sense of what's back there was entirely shut out. I mean, if you were on the bulletin boards, you must remember, you could see into the mind, or you felt as though you could see into the mind of the network. I knew there was like a heaving rhinoceros of a mainframe in town. I knew there was this wheel and crash of information that this was somehow connected to. But mostly I just knew there was this deep space. And I began to wonder what was back there. The book, Magic and Loss, is in part an effort to answer that question of what is back there, and also what is the relationship between the letters in the foreground, and now I'll talk about the pictures in the foreground, and that deep background. Instagram. So, one of the challenges for scientists who come to the internet is that they want to know what it is, and that, you know, only recently has there been attention paid to the physics of the internet. So Andrew Blum has this great book, The Tubes, about what undergirds the internet, the actual, you know, fiber optics, the actual fiber optic tubes. It's Andrew who set me thinking about what the sort of conceptual framework of layers that go, as he puts it, from dirt to Gmail. So the dirt layer are these tubes that separate very crudely the signals of light from each other. And then there are various layers on top of that, 7 layers, that lead to increasing abstraction of those signals until you finally get to the like highest, most rarefied level of abstraction. That's something like Gmail. But they've added an 8th layer. An 8th layer is, you might consider, the layer of the humanities. That's the layer of the language in the Gmail, the poetry and prose, the language that we write. And having been, you know, trained as a literary critic, so to speak, in the 90s, I think it's at least possible or interesting to imagine that the tubes are an epiphenomena of the poetry and prose on the top of the system. That the only reason we're speculating or imagining what these tubes are like, because even physicists have a hard time explaining them, is because of the look of the Instagram photos, the poetry that we write in Gmail. And also, that those things are in an endless loop. So this increasing abstraction, and this is how I get to frescoes, this increasing abstraction from the tubes on upward means that each layer has to suggest and speak to the next layer. So you couldn't, it's not as though you just are putting down layers like sand and glass. You actually have to be halfway embedded and integrated with the layer that's to come. So in this way, Wikipedia has beautiful very hypotactic prose on the subject of these layers. Let me look at it. Oh yeah, in computing, an abstraction layer or abstraction level is a way of hiding the implementation details of a particular set of functionality, allowing the separation of concerns to facilitate interoperability and platform independence. All right, so I want to talk about...
C++,
exactly. So I want to, so you probably know, he's referring to machine code, talking more, the computer language, unlike BASIC, that talks very closely to machines. Increasing levels of abstraction. Sometimes I think that the panic around the internet and the unwillingness to see it as an extension even of civilization is panic, simply panic around abstraction. And where your treasure is, there your faith will be also. Because I like abstraction, because the physical world makes me anxious, because I would rather be at home reading a book and or using a computer, I am comfortable with abstraction. And because I like to write, I'm comfortable with abstraction. Remember when your friends first started using email and texting? You learned that some of your friends just don't know how to write or like to write. You know, they were great on the phone, they're great in person, but they just weren't writing you long emails, and some people suddenly had a gift for it. Well, my advisor in graduate school, Mark Schell, used to talk about finance this way. That, you know, he makes an incredibly elaborate and interesting argument about anti-Semitism, for example, being grounded in a fear of abstraction related to finance. So, you know, if you think of the logic of the gold, those who hold on to the gold standard, who don't like inflationary currencies, they like material culture. They like gold that's gold. Or gold, or at best, gold that's inscribed with a few letters, but not too literate. When it moves to paper money, it generates a certain amount of anxiety. When it moves to electronic pulses, it's really starting to be in the hands of the banks, or starting to be in the hands of some ominous force. If you want, someone should really make a great video of the great minds of the world, including Joey Ito, explaining Bitcoin. Because it is so, I think it's easier probably to explain the engineering behind the internet than it is to explain Bitcoin. And also, every person explaining Bitcoin starts with, all right, I'm going to make it really simple. And then 15 minutes later, they're telling you, so there's a differential in the code that then can be maximized by this and turned into currency. So Bitcoin, we've moved to this crazy rarefied level of abstraction. Another thing that Mark Schell and others cite about civilization's progress toward, and this is, I'm being very schematic, but is obviously the replacement of war and battles with commerce. And Stephen Greenblatt says the only reason that we, and to show how this is civilizing, you know, the move away from war towards, in some places, the move away from war to commerce. Stephen Greenblatt says, the only reason we ever try to figure out how someone else feels is to sell them something. So if you think about the Silk Road, rather than fighting, rather than fighting all these civilizations and cultures that encountered each other, because they wanted to trade wool for silk, had to learn each other's languages, had to learn each other's cultures, had to learn each other's religions. It sounds like a cynical way to put it, but it tracks very well with, you know, when people become an interest group and a buying group, people begin to understand who they are. So empathy and compassion, especially across cultures, as a phenomenon of commerce, as a phenomenon of sales, really does make the case that there are certain sweetening effects of abstraction. Like moving away from battles into greater abstraction, might not be a bad thing. But there are always people panicking about it. You know, capitalism obviously generates a great deal of panic, so do the banks. Animal sacrifice, yields to prayer. Again, I'm being super schematic, but these are worth thinking about because there are always people who think that the substitute thing, the prayer, retains the scariness of the earlier thing, or at least the earlier thing had like a material correlate to it that made it understandable or made it tangible. So I just reviewed Nancy Jo Sales' book about, it's American Girls, Social Media, something, and American Teenagers. And it's a wonderful book for the reporting. It's where I got the idea of an aesthetic, or she pointed out there's an aesthetic called aesthetic. But one of the strange things in it is that it tracks these practices of like sexual banishment, of humiliation, that all happen in digital photography. So the stories seem scary, but they also seem kind of uncanny. So I'll give you just an example. Stories happen over and over again. A boy tries to have sex with a girl, she says no, and then he like photoshops her head on like an unattractive naked body and distributes that as a photograph of her. Or maybe he persuades her to give him a naked photograph, and then he circulates that as a way to humiliate her. And then sometimes he gets people to send him photographs and uses those photographs to, or gives those photographs to an older kid in exchange for beer. So like turns them into material. So we hear about these broken hearts and all these, and these terrible romances gone wrong. And I have to say I was thinking, this does sound bad, I'm glad no one's done that to me recently. At the same time, the anxiety about STDs, rape, sexual violence, bruising, and teen pregnancy is not in this. It's not in this. I don't know if you saw this, but the editor of Modern Love in the New York Times, can't remember his name, but he wrote recently that the early Modern Love columns, so I guess maybe even the early part of this century, were stories of people who'd had sex but didn't have an emotional connection to the person, and they were very worried about that. Now, the stories that come in are, we've had so much texting, but we've never had sex, or we've never met. We know each other so well. We know, like, we have, like, all these photographs, we have all this data, we have all this art around us about each other, but we've, like, never actually touched. So, you know, it's possible that the era of teen pregnancy and STDs and all the things that happen when two bodies come into contact with each other is far preferable and moral than, you know, this economy of trading photographs online. But it seems at least worth entertaining that this represents, well, I don't even want to put a value on it. It represents a natural progression of increasing abstraction, just like these these layers of in this conceit around how the internet is built. Instagram, like frescoes, bonds very, very well to the next layer down. I mean, you know that frescoes work only because they adhere to the plaster in very specific ways, and they have to be done quickly while the plaster dries. This is complicated to get into, but the way applications sit on the next layer down is not unlike this. They, like, part of them is integrated with the one below it. That's what the interoperability is in that thing. So they speak to the level beneath it. The aesthetic called aesthetic. So what I like about, on the one hand, tagging a photograph as aesthetic is similar to when Playboy, which no longer publishes pictures of naked women, did anyone see this? Playboy has changed its mandate, it's amazing. Playboy used to say that pictures of naked women were tasteful pictorials, I remember that. And aesthetic serves that purpose a little bit too. So if you tag something aesthetic, you're saying this is not pornography, this has like a different end. Nancy Jo Sales describes it, and it's evolved a little bit since she said this, but that it mixes a Sofia Coppola and the Virgin Suicides, that look of this kind of bruisey, moody girl selfies, and then something she describes as like real simple catalog. So there's like, you know, photographs of steel-cut oatmeal, you know, still lives of food, basically, and they're very clean. It's actually changed a lot, and that as that hashtag aesthetic, it's worth putting into Instagram to see the things that come up. It's men now and not women so much, and It definitely an attention, Instagram has always had this aesthetic about decay. You know, it's like, one of the things that fascinates me most about Apple is that they're really, really obsessed with their devices being oleophobic, afraid of oil, especially the oils and secretions of our bodies. And, you know, I was talking to a programmer friend the other day, and we were saying, Johnny Ive, you know, the designer at Apple, he just hates and thinks we're disgusting. Like, he just thinks our bodies are revolting. And he's like, how can we just not, like, let there be any trace that you were on this thing, on our thing? But Instagram did an amazing thing and pushed back on this, like, weird, immaculate, deathless aesthetic by saying what's interesting about photography is that it degrades. What's interesting about photography is that left out in the sun, it fades. And so introduced filter after filter that would take away from the old Canon colors that pop aesthetic that preceded it on Flickr and elsewhere online. So I think death is the organizing principle of the Instagram aesthetic, but one of the ways that it has been very, it's made an interesting study of flesh, is that these selfies, including the new ones by men, concentrate so much on the human body and on parts of the body that are unusual and weird. So especially the most recent, so first I'll talk about a banned form of photography called Thinspiration. I don't know what that is. So they're pictures of emaciation. You guys are like, yeah, Thinspiration. Thinspiration is a particular genre of photographs of emaciated women designed to inspire women to eat less and weigh less. And so they're just, so they're bones. And this kind of photography is alone in being banned on Tumblr, on at times on Instagram. Often if a celebrity posts a picture of herself looking too inspiringly thin, like at death's door, she is told, like, this is thinspo, and she has to take it down. So this is like a very exciting form of pornography on Instagram, because it's like potentially going to be taken down all the time. But Thinspiration is not ascendant anymore. What's ascendant now is Bigspiration, or I don't know what it is, muscles, whatever, men's version of body violence. So they're incredible pictures that I'll show you, but they're the top hashtag aesthetic pictures right now are pictures of male bodies that are like muscular beyond recognition, super vascular. You're like really looking as close to the layer under the skin of the body as possible. Like the way that the inspiration really showed you bones and, you know, almost organs protruding, this really shows you like it's as far as you can get with muscle. Like it just makes any statue you've ever seen look ridiculous. And on top of that are overlaid tattoos that like really call attention to the like light and shadow of these extreme bodies. To my knowledge, Bigspiration has not yet been banned, which is interesting. These sites are not really known for banning things. The community usually takes care of it. For now, I guess these photographs are being left alone. Partly, like virtually every pop art form, what is it going to do to the girls is everybody's fear. So I think it's possible that the inspiration, I mean, I say in the book that there's some great 18th century treatises about the damage to our brains done by novels, particularly to women, that I think one of this unnamed alarmist, unauthored alarmist tract about novels said that that novels instilled poison into the brain, into the veins of women, and got encouraged them to become promiscuous. Exact same argument being made about Instagram. So pop forms, we have great panic about what they're going to do to the children, what they're going to do to women. Men somehow can inspire each other with these photographs, and Instagram seems to do nothing but enshrine the photographs into my, I find that interesting. So what could be more abstract and aesthetic than aesthetic itself? It is incredible to me how fast, you know, the velocity of Instagram is what's amazing about it. It just, like, the things move so fast and they change so fast and they're mounted so fast. You know, something will go up, not my photographs, I can't get a like to save my life, but if you're one of these bigger exit guys or you're posting Finspo, you can expect hundreds of thousands of likes, you know, within such a short period of time. You know, sometimes when I thought I was looking back at that darkness in the screen, I wonder if I was just looking at, like, trying to register, and today I think of it too, when I can sometimes get past Apple's interface and wonder what's out there. Is it just that there are 4 billion people somehow also, like, involved in this project of making this thing? And 4 billion language users, 4 billion image users. Just to imagine that we are in this shared cultural project together, maybe that's the thing that is, you know, that's the name I might give to that face of God that I persist in seeing back there. I want to say a tiny bit. Are we doing Q&A or how do you guys like to roll?
I think they're
going to
want to ask you questions. So
okay.
That's
all right. Let me go to. So the insistence, I think, of Instagram on the absolute primacy of the body and also the dying body. I mean, those pictures are very, very idiosyncratic on Instagram, and then made stranger are the looks of skin and what you can tell about organs and muscles, made stranger by the filters put on them, by the dynamic range that's exaggerated.
What do you mean by dying?
The dying body. Well, mostly just how different the bodies on Instagram and other photo sharing sites, how different they look compared to this, right? Like, this, the internet and its emissaries or gadgets purport to be immortal. Obviously, they're, like, constantly dying and becoming obsolete. But the cloud, which incidentally, you know, the invention of some very eschatologically minded executives at Compaq, who really believed in the afterlife, invent this thing called the cloud. The cloud is, in theory, where all the secretions of our mind, all the photographs, all the words, live after we die materially, right? So the Instagram has this, and you all may know that, you know, the alpha males of the internet, the Elon Musk types, the brass at Google, are literally trying to hack death. You know, that they see our mortality as a bug. They don't see it the way poets see it, as a feature. You know, as they say, like, one of our greatest, what's most interesting about us is that we die, unlike rocks. Yes. Well, let me come to your question, which seems like a doozy, so I'm excited to address the question. I want to quickly say something about the digital humanities. I do think the internet has engendered in us an almost romantic infatuation with material culture and with our bodies. I don't know if you may have heard that in Northern California, of all places, a certain cadre of young men who felt they were addicted to their phones, they couldn't stop looking at their phones, have started to take an LSD breakfast. So they take a little of the hallucinogen subdermally, like they put it under their skin in the mornings, maybe they take it on their tongue, so that they lose interest in that boring Levittown, the bird's eye view of Levittown, you know, interface of their phones, and find the faces of people on the bus so fascinating, right? It's like the irregularities in our faces, the thing that cannot be digitized. I talked recently to Paul Debevec, who creates digital humans, so like renderings in CGI, but very, very detailed renderings of living people. One of the things he can do is he's done, as part of Steven Spielberg's Shoah project, he's created digital versions of Holocaust survivors who, after their death, can speak to groups and answer new questions in their own voices based on things that they've written before. So like the sound is spliced together, and you know they could potentially be made to say things that they wouldn't have said, and they will seem to be saying them. He just did Barack Obama in a digital, an animated digital, digital human, digital rendering. One of the things he said though is that there will always be an uncanny valley, even for the best physicists, with digital humans, because our pores evidently refract light in each one of them in such a different way, and different depending on where we turn our heads, because the volume of oil and hair and so forth in each pore is so different and contingent, and then the one next to it is just as arbitrary, and then you can imagine the chessboard problem proceeding across all of our faces. So we basically have two settings. We have a setting for a digital image of someone, and then we have a setting when we actually see someone. If I just spoke about, I spoke about the book to my daughter's first grade class not long ago. I said basically the magic is that feeling you get like, wow, this new game, how does it work? This is amazing. The loss is a sort of depressed, sick feeling you have when you've been on the internet too long. And then I opened it up for questions, which I will do here too, I promise. and they said, and the only question I got was, why don't you look like your picture? And I was like, that is a perfect question. My picture on the book is a very beautiful rendering, like a John Singer Sargent painting made of pixels on a computer that has very, very little to do with the like light and shadows of my face in space. I mean, not only was it made in a studio with professional, you know, someone painted a face on top of me, painted hair on top of me, and then put it on a computer and then painted that thing, you know? And I love that picture. That's Athena to me. That I put all kinds of stuff around her to make a story about her. But she doesn't bear much resemblance to me. And the renewed appreciation, I think, for bodies in space comes partly because that gap is newly interesting to us. And it's being constantly thematized for us on Instagram. So I think I'll wrap up by saying, you know, we look at Instagram and say that what we see there, we have the same anxiety about Instagram that we have about screens immemorially, from mirrors, even to reflective glass. You're either hiding behind a screen, and that's what's wrong with it, or you're staring into the glass, and that's what's wrong with it, because you're just admiring yourself. You're being a narcissist. In fact, the photographs on the selfies, the aesthetic selfies on Instagram, have become increasingly vulnerable. In some ways, people are showcasing in many ways, they're showcasing their vanity. They're letting themselves be seen trying to look pretty, which to me seems like, you know, one of the most, a very vulnerable act. I certainly wouldn't have been capable of it at 14, 15. So, showing our skin and showing our fragility in those pictures. Especially how odd they've gotten. I mean, they look actually naked. I think I reviewed the Miss Universe pageant a few years ago, and in the bikini competition, I don't know, I feel like I didn't mean to talk about sex very much, but this isn't really talking about sex. So they have a lot of competition color on their bodies. They're covered with this tanning stuff. And on top of that, they have a lot of muscles. And then they wear bikinis. And I was sort of like, this is how you're not naked. Like, this is how you put on a crustacean. Like, you just put on armor and exoskeleton and walk down the stage. Like, anyone looks more naked than this on the, you know, on the subway. And I think that, you know, a pushback on digital has been like, how can we find those things that can't be digitized and as much as possible make them sort of sing on Instagram. So I think the aesthetic called aesthetic is this very rarefied, thanatotic, death-like aesthetic that you can see in, I have a comparison of some old frescoes with some Kim Kardashian selfies, if you want to make the comparison yourself. I actually put them on the internet too. Last thing, I know I said last thing, but new last thing is the digital humanities. So I think that there is a high road use for them and a low road use for them. The high road use is we need desperately not to lose our heads in the proliferation of images and words that, you know, 4 billion of us are now participating in. You know, the deconstructionists predicted, and the 20th century literary criticism predicted this proliferation of language, predicted that we would have this like crazy polyglot system of significance that we would be, you know, practically unable to manage, and that we would, that our only response could be play, the computer. And we keep forgetting that, and instead ceding this ground to scientists who tell us about neurotoxins and who, you know, look at words, images, and music and tell us that these things are poison instilled in our veins. And we keep reading those books and forgetting our training. We can't mistake the new highly stylized artificial order of the internet for reality itself. We just can't. I mean, it would be, it's, look through Donald Trump's Twitter feed. You can see exactly the performative language, the kind of tropes he uses. There's no reason to like begin to diagnose or try to understand brain lobes that have to do with racism when we have at our disposal all kinds of ways of thinking about those speech acts. All cultural forms and conceits that gain currency and influence, epic poetry, the Catholic Mass, the British Empire, and photography, do so by purporting to be reality. The internet has so seductively passed as reality for so long that, you know, this is our job to jump in and make sense of it. And the low road use, marketing, plastics, go for it. Marketing and branding, as I found out working with venture capital, is where left brain engineering meets the culture. And it's a terrible word for it, but it's okay that it's that dismissive. You all may know the story of Tinder, an amazing technology using, you know, using geolocation to help set up people looking to quickly meet each other. But Tinder was nothing, the technology, it was nothing, the app was nothing, even the left swipe, right swipe was nothing, if Whitney Wolf, the chief marketing officer, hadn't been an English or a humanities major, a liberal arts major, and had tried very, very hard to determine what convinces a girl to go on a date where all she knows about the guy is what he looks like and he's attracted to her picture. And that conversation, you know, when do you try to understand someone because you want to sell them something? Whitney Wolf had done her homework and understood something about female sexuality, about romance, about images, and she was able to create a fairly sturdy dating system only because she was able to draw women to it. If that sounds cynical, if you think Tinder is terrible, if you think that people have like been tricked into going on it, that's not the job for you. But there are other, you know, I did some marketing work for this hamburger made of plants. It's actual USDA meat, but it's made from plants. There's like blood extracted from spinach and other places that is like, it actually makes a piece of meat. You know, the ends of this Stanford engineer biochemist is to put livestock farming out of business and thus save the planet. But people feel kind of squeamish about meat from in petri dishes. So a long time into it, you know, I had to sort of figure out what is meat, what is kosher, why are we like not meant to be avid around meat? How could that break be put on our relation to meat? And incidentally, these jobs, which just seem totally mysterious to engineers head down in product, that turn that thing into a burger that people would eat, it's exactly what you all are being trained to do in the humanities. And you know, that one interested me because I liked the ends of the company I thought the engineering was really fascinating, and creating that, you know, higher, that upper level, the language around it, also interesting to me. I mean, writing the ingredients list for something that is baldly GMOs is really, really fascinating. I'll just, one small thing that came out of that, he's obsessed with how GMOs are not that bad, and that they've become like this bugbear. But one of the things he pointed out is that something like 60% of Americans want all food labeled if it contains any DNA. So it was, what was great about that was like, wow, what is DNA? Anyway, you get to have these kind of conversations, and they're fascinating, and you know, you are getting training for real jobs that are out there. So that's so I don't think digital humanities is this like, I don't think it's like the worst of digital and the worst of the humanities. I think it is like, you know, fast becoming all the humanities, and it also has this very clear application to, you know, where STEM sciences meet business. So that's today. I really want to hear your questions, especially yours, but everyone's. Thanks a lot.
Let me use words slowly because they will be probably unfamiliar to you.
Okay.
Part of what you are working with is the amount of information represented. Cantor wrote information. And the axioms for it are only about information. The precision which you would need looks like it would go as 2 to the 407 or 2 to the 408. So when you're talking about those pores and so on,
yeah,
that's gross compared to the precision which one is thinking of for actually looking at the understructure of physics.
Yeah.
Einstein's work was not for emitting a photon, but rather for the photon hitting a solid and the electron becomes off.
Right. I you know what, you're actually the second mathematician, programmer, scientist who's told me he thinks that the Paul Debevec digital humans problem could be solved. That it's not as elaborate as I think it is. And he's an artist and a filmmaker. So it's possible that it couldn't be cracked by computer-generated images as we have them now, but that it is, yes.
It is far removed from what we presently have with the largest computer systems around.
Yeah. But what's cool about it is, for people in the humanities, is that the end stop is you need a face that looks like a face, or that is like, yet again, another reasonable facsimile of a face in the real world, but closer to what that doesn't make us feel that nauseated, uncanny thing. And since that's the end of the physics project, I think that's consistent, at least with my argument, that there is no computer engineering without the humanities, that the two things grow up together.
The appellate division, court in Washington, D.C., has used software which I wrote for the bulletin board community.
Yeah.
And to go after Trojans.
Oh wow.
FWKCS content signature system.
I'd like to hear more about this. Will you come up to me after and tell me a little more? All right.
Take other people.
Yeah. Anyone else? Yeah.
Yeah, so we're talking a bit about sort of, was it Spielberg having an issue with the Holocaust?
Yeah.
That, something about that rubbed me the wrong way.
Really?
Yeah, the sensation.
What was it? Posthumous people? The Holocaust? What bugged you?
Just the fact that their stories are being portrayed from their faces. Something like, if it's in a written medium, right? Let's say in a book with a quotation, there's something I feel more genuine about that than sort of a digitalized face speaking their words to you in their voice. It somehow feels more artificially contrived and therefore less genuine, even if it's maybe closer to reality. So I was wondering if you had any thoughts about that sort of like aestheticization and therefore removal from genuineness that you sort of mean. I think that sort of mirrors things that you've seen in the internet or Instagram.
Yeah. Well, I do think that I've had a fair amount now of experiences in very good virtual reality, and but what I've learned from people who now, you know, spend half their lives in it, is that it creates a hunger for real life experiences. And you know, if I'm ever asked what's next, it seems very clear to me that it's an anti-digital aesthetic that you begin to see being thematized on Instagram. So like. You know, what about us can't be digitized? What, like, they got our in the early days of criticism of the internet, Nicholson Baker said, they're going to take away our card catalogs. And meanwhile, like, come on, Dewey Decimal System numbers cards, like, these things are, like, on a continuum with being digital when they existed, you know? So our card catalogs are not what makes us human. Even potentially, you know, our books are not what makes us human. Our poetry, our photography, all these things can be digitized. But it's possible that our mortality, which the internet defines itself against, is the thing that can't be digitized. And that uncanny feeling you get around this survivor, if we saw him, not yet dead, but if we saw him 10 years hence answering questions, it's generally just, you know, foreseeing this possible problem, the Shoah Project has. He can only say the things he's said before in writing and the things he said out loud, and they use his speech, right? So they're splicing together speech. He can't go off his own script, but it's meant to like allow you to interact with him after he's died. So children can say like, well, what happened when you arrived at Theresienstadt or whatever? And then he says, and then he gives an answer that he's given before. But the feeling of the uncanny valley thing that you have there, they're like, I don't really want to be part of this, I think is you're like, you can't take our deaths away from us, you know? It's something about, there's just something, but I'm speculating, because it's really impressionistic when you get into virtual reality, like, how much are you willing to forgive, you know, these new universes? You know, we've done a nice job with photography of being like, oh yeah, that's him, you know, or why don't you look like your picture? But I'm still gonna forgive that's you, it's not you. You know, and people have different thresholds, and the fact that people are actually nauseated in the presence of virtual reality, I am, and when there's latency, you know what that is, yeah, suggests that like there's something really intensely biological. Keeping us from, I don't know, allowing like computers to die or something. But yeah, I'm with you. I mean, it's like a very controversial project.
You have not mentioned consciousness, and for some reason it keeps coming up in my head.
Yeah.
And I'm anticipating you to get to it, you know? And I don't know why, but it's just bugging me. And When you die, because you talked about mortality, when you die, my personal view is that you disappear, that there is nothing that survives other than the molecules and the matter that you're made of. But while you're alive and you have this consciousness, I wonder what that is. I mean, if it's analogous to me to a field, like a magnetic field around a spinning iron core in the Earth that kind of is there or isn't there, has some scope to it, but if you remove the iron, then that just dissipates.
Yeah.
And one other thing, because we'll probably go on after me, but I'd like to respond to that. Jacob Bronowski did a series called The Ascent of Man.
Oh, yeah.
Do you remember that?
Yeah.
And one of those, one of the episodes, this was back in the 70s, we were just being born, I guess, 73 or 74. One of the episodes is on tolerance. Tolerance. And it's the uncertainty principle in one respect, but he really says it's a misnomer. And the other thing is he shows a face and how every day you look different. And if we didn't have tolerance, you would look different the next day and we'd be unrecognizable. And he weaves that together. And his mother died at in Poland at Auschwitz. And he finalizes that episode by going there. And he walks out, this was unscripted, because I had the DVD in there. He goes out there in a suit, and he puts his hand into the dirt, the mud, it's like a...
Yeah.
And he brings this up, and he knows his mother's ashes are there.
Yeah.
And then he quotes Cromwell, which, from the battles of Christ, can you, I'm paraphrasing it, but can you accept that maybe you're wrong?
Mm-hmm.
Now, have you seen that?
I know they recently re-released it, and I read that quotation, or I did see
yeah.
that clip on YouTube.
Yeah,
yeah.
yeah.
But,
okay. but you see the scope of this thing.
Yeah.
Know? Yeah. So those are the two things that are, I mean, there's other things. You're amazing, you know, I'm out of breath listening to you.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Try to answer that.
No, I'm just saying, yeah, I mean, very brilliant, and I'm not used to being around people like that, so.
That's
what
pretty
you're
good,
at
but,
that.
But,
yeah.
No, that's, okay. So those are two things that I have to say.
She's a philosophy major,
yeah.
So she might go on about that.
Okay.
I don't know the state of the work on consciousness, but I will say part of the, philosophers, I will say part of the effect of that darkness in the internet, or part of the effect of being on the internet for so long, has been, I keep shaving away the things that I think are uniquely human. So there's a part in the book where I dumped a glass of water by accident into my laptop, and I was reading a book about someone who decided that he had been to heaven, he had a near-death experience, a doctor. And all he had concluded was that consciousness survives bodily death. So I have that book, something, Proof of Heaven. And then my computer drowned, and I took it to the Apple store, and you know, like that panic. I was just like, I'm gonna lose data, this panic. And in fact, I had lost all the data in my, you know, soulful, breathing, holy Macintosh, you know? And, but the guy assured me that it didn't matter that all this firmware was scorched. It all survived bodily death in the cloud. And, you know, I was like, what is that thing that survived the death of this thing? Because I might as well have been carrying my heart to the Apple store, you know? But something of me had survived. Well, photographs of my children survived. Little diary entries I'd written had survived. The manuscript for my book survived. There was nothing that hadn't survived that I thought was me. So those things were now in the cloud. This thing was scorched, and I could live without it. So what was the part that was like consciousness? Like if I had put it all in this thing, and part of the discovery of the book I made is that I don't think it's these. I think that, you know, all this art we're making is will live forever. That's taken care of. That's the immortal part. So what's the mortal part? You know, what's the mortal part? What dies when we die? And, you know, the next book is on this. Richard Rorty was my mentor, my advisor as an undergraduate, the cognitist. You know, he makes a lot of what dies when we die. What dies when you die? You have to make it something. You know, you have to make it something.
I guess keying off the death theme, I had not thought about, until you mentioned it, the human body dying, but the mechanics living on. But then I realized that, you know, anyone who's been on Facebook for long enough now has Facebook friends who are dead. And I have two friends actually who died independently of themselves within a week of each other last month. And one of them keeps popping up in one of my, you know, best friends, because he was one of those people who was retired and spent all his time on Facebook talking about how much he loved Angie Dickinson and, you know, all this kind of stuff. He was constantly on it and constantly commenting on people's things, and he was a huge presence on there. And it's almost like I think of it as magic and loss and sometimes the absurd, in terms of the magic being what you can create of your life. Like, you know, if someone says, oh, I broke up with my boyfriend and I saw his Facebook page and he looks like he's having the time of his life, and I'm like, well, nobody posts photos of themselves sobbing and crying, and, you know, maybe I should do something like that on our project. It's like, why? No, they're all like singing and dancing and having the time of their lives, even if their heart is breaking. And then the loss being that, you know, I have an aunt who's passed away who's on Facebook. I have an uncle who's passed away who's my Facebook friend. You know, it's such a weird connection.
Yeah.
And that's what lives on. You know, you talk about be careful of what you put out there because so-and-so will find you, or they'll look you up, and, you know, and thank God Facebook did not exist when I was a teenager. I would never have a job. But, you know, it's also, like, be careful what you put up there, because that's what's going to live after you die, and that's the life that will be remembered by who knows what the medium will be. But I'm very into genealogy, so this kind of touches home. But your generations to come will see about you and know about you. And the absurdity being that it's on something like Facebook, and, you know, my father has been dead 20 years. Hardly anyone in my life now ever knew him. But, you know, I put him up there on Facebook. I put an album of him, and I felt so stupid doing it. I don't know why, but it was the only way I had to say this person existed.
Yeah.
And he meant something to me.
Right.
And you don't know him, but this is what he looked like in 1960. This is what he looked like in 1980 with huge sideburns. And the absurdity behind that too, that the medium, and even things like funeral homes being able to light virtual candles for people
and
sign books, and, you know, apologies to anyone who's done that. I've been tempted to myself. But yeah, it's almost like the magic you create, the loss that you feel when that magic is gone, and then the absurdity, it's like, but why were we even interested in this in the first place?
There was some, Anthony Lane review of a movie a long time ago where he said, in an inspired piece of casting, the entire world is played by the United States of America. Sometimes I worry, when the entire internet is played by Facebook, or the entire internet is played by Twitter, or the entire internet is played by Instagram. So I do want to say something separately about Facebook, which is that it is a retirement community now, and a funeral home, and it is a lot about preservation. Mm-hmm. Where Instagram, you see these like beautiful but like bruised bodies that are like kind of living, dying, druggy looking, thin, whatever. On Facebook, it's like, you know, perfectly orderly. I mean, first of all, mixed cases, people having conversations as, you know, good Republicans and Democrats and good debates or whatever. And then, you know, if you hang out in the bruising mob of Twitter, you would just think we were an entirely different race of people. Mm-hmm. Like, we just have different vocabularies, we write differently, we must be made of something completely different. But people in the humanities know that, you know, that, that like, those forms speak through us. And we get, you know, what we're supposed to do on Facebook. And one of the things we're supposed to do is memorialize people. I mean, there is, you know, now there's a tradition of Father's Day, posting pictures of your, you know, your dead father. And that gets a lot of people rally behind that. And they chronicle their cancers, and they, you know. So that's one thing. The other thing is, as for the persistence of memory of who we once were, you know, all this stuff about us, you know, we used to fear in pop culture ephemera, you know, it was just always like, oh, this stuff is so, it's bad because it's so short and it doesn't last. Well, now it's bad because it lasts. You know, newspaper, you'll never get away from that. It used to be rabbit for fish the next day. I don't think our descendants will know who we were, and this goes to the question of consciousness. They will know how we posed.
Mm-hmm.
They will know what Athena was. They will know how I wanted to look in a photograph designed by an artist in Photoshop. They'll know, who Page88 is. That's my Twitter handle. The kind of things that she says, the kind of things that I work on that are very stylized, that are written to Twitter specs. You know, and they'll make a guess about, like, God, she was a bust this one time that she was getting trolled and running scared, or like she shouldn't have hung on in this debate too long, maybe, if they parse it. But I don't think they'll say they know me from that. And part of what consciousness must be, or what, I don't know, what I might be to myself, has got to be something that's not there. Because I'm too much the artist in those, you know, in those spots. I mean, right up to the time of the introduction of the World Wide Web, novelists like Joan Didion and Philip Roth were writing characters with their own names. So you were always like writing some character into existence. And now we all do it. I mean, we're called on to use the techniques of fiction and learn these forms. I mean, for heaven's sakes, like Twitter cannot be a realist form. There's no poetic form that's as tight as that, with like, you know, small details like if you want to have an exchange with, if I want to have an exchange with you at Heather, but cheat out to everyone so everybody can read our cool exchange, I have to put a dot in the beginning of it so that left it's missed by someone that doesn't follow both of us. And people do that. I do it. You make these crazy decisions about hashtagging, and obviously you have 140 characters. Like, they couldn't have stymied us more, you know? And yet some people thrive in that. So I think it's a very artificial regime. I think the things we put up there are, you know, our avatars, and for people who ask, and a lot of people seem to, how we can protect our kids online, just make them more authoritative, you know, users of these tools. So like, if you want to do self-portraits, topless self-portraits of yourself, there is a great tradition of people doing topless self-portraits and topless portraits of themselves, and you should be aware of that tradition and aware of, you know, the consequences of that for your authority later. There are certain jobs you get hired for out of that, and certain maybe that you don't. But those aren't mistakes. Those aren't mistakes. I mean, the uploading process is, you know, there are enough breaks on you to keep you from putting pictures, topless photographs of yourself on Instagram. It's not something you fall over and accidentally do. It's not id-driven. It's not id-driven. Like, you know, it's not driven by just like the monster beast in us. It's the artist in us. Taking, you know, in Nancy Jo Sales' book, taking sometimes 300 different photographs and then choosing from them and then using software that elongates you and stretches out your neck. I mean, you're just acting like an artist there. And when I say art, of course I don't mean good art, you know. I'm amazed that people resist the idea that images might be art when, like, you can hear, like, barrel making and julienning a carrot described as an art, you know. This is, like, would have looked like art, you know, any time in civilization, bad and good. So it's like, there's something wrong with your attention, because it should be focused on me, and should your mother. So it's pathological. So I think we don't like it when people are looking at screens. We just, because they're not looking at us. And and also because of this anxiety around screens. I mean, there's probably more anxiety when you see someone in, wives used to worry about their husbands in Ames chairs with like the big headphones, because they're like consciously shutting out family life in that open, you know, open plan living room. It's the same, it's just this like onanistic badness of like, you're looking at something, you must be a narcissist, or else why would you be gazing at a screen, reflective screen, this is reflective. Or you must be trying to hide. You know, that Janice Riveway book, Reading the Romance, yeah, the great book. Just that book, like, readers are just like, they're screening people out. they've got a newspaper, they've got something that's standing between you and the other person. And then you start saying, you know, the problem with that is, it's XYZ frontal cortex. You know what? The problem with that is that you are seeing too much sexy things and you're going to think bad thoughts. The problem with that is, I mean, the like evolution of the language around what was wrong with television is a study in sophistry. It is amazing. It's like, does it cause obesity? Does it cause the jump cuts on MTV are the problem? No, the commercials are the problem. Because, but then, oh no, you're watching Netflix without commercials. So I think that something probably in a power dynamic between parents and children and teachers and children gets interfered with because of the screen, and then we leverage a lot of scientific and values-laden language to get our kids to pay more attention to us. They also don't like the look of people. I mean, it is like seeing the masturbators. I mean, you just don't like the look of someone looking slack, you know? It's just like people, your kids don't, you don't take pictures, talk about things you don't show on Facebook. I don't take pictures of my kids watching television, even though that's half their lives, you know, looking at a screen. Just don't, whatever, that's what I, not what I, I'd rather show them crying to the world, because then they just look human. But, you know, it's like the art of absorption versus the performative.
Yeah.
You want your kids to be, like, out, not absorbing something.
I think we got time for one more question.
Okay.
So this is very timely for me, because my professor recommended your book, like, the day before I got the email. So you're very au courant on my newsfeed. So you mentioned the 20th century structuralists sort of anticipating this, like, incoherence that we see on the internet and how play is a response to that. And I'm curious if you could say a little more about how you've observed the tone of internet culture and life, and whether you're seeing these major, sort of like, whether or not that the idea of tone fits into this more existential idea you have about us questioning the basic tenets of what it means to be human. Do you feel that happening on like a cultural level or an interpersonal level in terms of how people interact and think about and conceptualize their own life?
I think that if one of the things that's in that dark space is the, well, my mind anyway, can't register, can't take in the fact of nearly 4 billion other minds. It just, you know, I can barely begin to think that there's a mind like mine in your skull, you know, let alone the 4 billion. So let's just say that it's like beholding the night sky to think about all those people. Then the further anxiety that what we see of those people hear experience of those people is their dialects. And it is a kind of polyglottism that we have never, there's not even a literature around thinking about that level of polyglottism in linguistics, as far as I know, in anthropology. And I was at Google not long ago, and Google, it's funny, Google and the New York Times have the same terrified reaction to one quarter of the internet, YouTube comments. It's like, this is where you see the worst of people somehow in YouTube comments. And you just say YouTube comments and people start to be like, people are subliterate, they're barbaric, they're terrible, they're whatever. I mean, I've spent a lot of time reading YouTube comments, and yes, you hear, if you read down under something about Islam, you hear people saying like, Muslims are cutthroats. There's this like very like, it seems like Pope and Dryden era, Swift kind of language about religion or about, or it can be very like bawdy or whatever. And then, yes, there's some swearing. There's so much evidence that, you know, probably 2/3 of the people on there are speaking in second or third languages. I mean, the typos that they make, what they don't do proper, this and that capitalization. If my Chinese, if I could even crudely bring myself to get the courage to write a comment on a Chinese YouTube video in Chinese, like, it would be the best, you know, it would be a banner day for my brain. And in fact, like, we look at this thing and are just like, these people are disgusting. I think I sort of say in the book, My dissertation's a lot on Henry James, and especially this particular scene in the American scene where he's at Ellis Island beholding immigrants coming in. And it just, it's such an affront to the organization of his brain to see like these swarming people with their different languages and their different styles and different smells. And it really sounds like, you know, an ordinary educated American talking about Twitter, talking about YouTube comments. It just is like, who are these people? They can't spell, you know, they didn't go to Columbia, they don't know anything, why are they here? Why are they talking to me? I just hate how they talk in short sentences and they all connect with each other and it's just, you know, there's something revolting about it. I'm sorry, you said,
what does that do
to us? The style.
Yeah. Well, yeah, I think that's a really interesting response, this like huge spectrum of humanity. Exposure to, but
yeah,
what's that going to do to the psyche?
there's a little of what doesn't kill us makes us stronger. I really, really like to, and you know, sometimes I think I say in the book, like I try to say, I have to continue to expose myself to white nationalism, to anti-Islam, to like certain kinds of rhetoric. I don't block trolls. I don't, you know, worry about triggers, because my immune system like needs to be exposed to these different idioms. I'll become a better writer. I'll learn, like, you know, I won't make mistakes that I've made before. You know, I once put in an article in the New York Times, I quoted a tweet, and the tweet, the woman who had it had a black avatar, her face looked black in the picture, and the quote mentioned the drink Kool-Aid. It was toward making the point that she, like, it doesn't suck when you drink Kool-Aid, but then it's a flavor that you don't expect it to be. And I was totally schooled on Twitter as like, you can't even quote something that says Kool-Aid in proximity to a black person as a white person with a white avatar. And that is a language system, you know, ideally, I don't get defensive and say, I didn't mean it, I was just quoting you, you know, like Donald Trump with his six-sided star. You know, oh, that was just a mistake, I didn't know that. Ignorance is no defense. Like, I had to be like, I won't make that mistake again. You know, it's like learning a language. Nobody speaks the whole language of Twitter or YouTube, and you're gonna make like huge faux pas for a long time trying to learn it. But so I tell myself that, and then after like a horrible few days of getting, you know, trolled and creamed and in the Twitter Coliseum and emerging in a body bag almost, I am like, no, I'm just one of those Van Gogh street kids who says like regular beatings give me character, and like there's nothing, I'm getting grit. Someday I'll have grit. So I'm not sure, but I, you know, Joe Ito at, you know, the media lab at MIT is really into like the microbes run everything. Like we only think we're in charge up here. It's like the microbes in our gut. And you know, I think of those idioms as like this super diverse, you know, microflora that are, you know, testing us all the time, like asking us to, you know, be stronger, broaden our brains. You know, when you try to learn a new interface, I've had this with Snapchat. I'm just like, oh no, I've reached the limits. I dutifully signed up for Pinterest. I got some followers. I made some boards. But this time, I'm not going to be able to get this. Like, I'm not going to be able to understand what's good about a snap, how to make one, how to send them, even where they are. I don't understand the interface. And then ideally, you get it. And then one day you don't, and then you die.
That seems like a good place. Anyway, thank you so much.